Good evening. I'm Steve Rabel.
And I'm Angela Russell. Welcome to a special KIRO 7 presentation commemorating J.P. Patches.
Countless viewers grew up watching Chris Wedes play the role of J.P. here on KIRO 7 for years. And we all lost a friend when Chris passed away in July.
Well, earlier today, a celebration of J.P. Patches was held at the Seattle Center.
And now KIRO 7 brings you that funny and touching event.
At the tone, the time will be 7 o'clock. Exactly.
Cuckoo clock. Hold it, Sam. My director, Sam Gefilterfish, always likes to have the cuckoo clock come out, spill water on me. What do I get? Bumps and bruises. What does Sam get? He gets a laugh. Well, I've got news for you, Sam Gefilterfish. This happens to be the J.P. Patches special. Wait a minute. The Sam Gefilterfish show? I think you've got it all wrong. And besides, I'm in charge. What can you do? I'm going back to bed. That's what I'm going to do. I'm so tired. Well, 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 I guess we did it to him that time, Patches pals. Yeah, Patches, well, Sam, this happens to be an old tape, 1974. Now that you know who's in charge, let's start the program, J.P. Patches special, okay? Wow, memories, boys and girls. You know, the J.P. Patches program started way back in 1958, when you were a lot younger. And so was I. We'll get the popcorn a-poppin' and the VCRs a-rollin'. We're gonna be here for the next hour with memories.
Okay, let's find out, was that joke or it was a...
Hey, wait.
You have to tell another joke, and then we'll see if you get another. Then you win.
It's good.
You never know, you might get a...
It'll be tied up. It'll be one, two, one.
One hit, one miss.
But so far you have one.
You don't have any.
Cut it out, will you? Okay. How can you tell if a gorilla's been in your refrigerator?
Let's see, how can you tell if a gorilla's been in a...
I don't know how. Because his footprints are in a pizza.
Oh, you. Hi, everybody. I want to say hi to men and women, boys and girls, moms and dads, aunts and uncles, managers, middle managers, managing managers, seafarer clowns, pirates, puppeteers, mimes, shopkeepers, shoplifters, young and old, short and tall, big and small, and Patches pals. Did I leave anyone out? Thank you for being here. Thank you so much for being here. My name is Pat Cashman. But today, I wish you would just call me Pat Chespal. And welcome to all of you for being here. We have an estimated attendance today of about 65,000 people, and we thank you. You know, Chris Wedes was born April 3rd, 1928. And as you also know, he died July 22nd of this year. J.P. Patches of Seattle was born, says here, February 10th, 1958 at KIRO TV. And of course, he'll live forever. I was lucky enough to get to know both of them, Chris Wedes, the real man, and J.P. Patches. And one of them was a rubber-faced, cheery, good-natured, kind of troublemaker, insurrectionist clown, and the other one was J.P. Patches. They were very much the same. Hey, do you want to take a look at the set that you remember? Look at this. Of course, this was the centerpiece, and this is Grandpa TikTok. Thank you. And, of course, they never showed J.P. talking to Grandpa TikTok in a two-shot because J.P. provided the voice for Grandpa TikTok. Back here would be, Newman usually would be back here, and he'd be operating the eyeballs like that, and he'd have the mouth going up and down, and he'd say, like, hi, J.P. Well, that's why he did it, not me. Well, in the first incarnation of this clock, they had a little tiny face on it. And so parents started calling in and saying, you know what, we use your show to tell our kids when to go to school, and we can't tell what time it is. It's true. So they put this bigger clock face on there, so in almost every shot of the show, you could tell what time it was. This is the same kind of clock the kids were used to anyway. This is what you would have in a classroom. Grandpa TikTok. This is the original Grandpa TikTok, by the way. The other things you see here are faithfully restored and recreated, like this one, the Palovac. I'd like to demonstrate the Palovac for you if I could. I think we're ready to do that, are we? All right. So as you know, the Palovac, you only saw the Palovac a couple times a year up towards Christmas time, and JP would use it to find out if kids were naughty or nice. Let's see if he's still, Mr. Palovac has those powers. As a test, let me put the name of Boris S. Wart in here. Let's see what happens. And then Yeah, that's pretty decided, wasn't it? Let's pick a name. Yell a name out to me. Yeah, okay. Let me put that in there and see what happens. Ah, you're nice. We've also got, hang on a second, I think I hear the phone ringing, and yes, it's a long distance call. I'll put you on hold. I got something to do here. Yeah, okay. So those are just some, and then of course you know Gorst over here, and the bookworm. You do the voice. There's the peak of you, and of course, everybody's favorite, or many people's favorite, the incredible technology of the ICU TV. I don't know how they did it, but JP could sit here and he could see kids at home. It's incredible technology. We forgot how to do it somewhere along the way. I think they're working on it again. Do that again. Maybe we can hear you. That's pretty good. That's pretty good. That's the sound that they would make as he would turn the dials. And parents, as you know, would send in their kid's birthday and the name of the kid, and then perhaps where his present or her present might be hiding. And so kids would go, it's behind the washing machine. How could he have known that? The ICU TV must be real. A big component of the show was the importance of music and sound effects. And that doesn't happen by accident, not by magic. No, it happens because of real humans. And there's a human called, on the show, Mr. Music Man. Well, there were multiple Mr. Music Men, but this was the fellow that was there the longest. He was really good. Would you welcome Dwayne Smart? have a chair there, Mr. Smart.
Thank you.
I could not have had a last name like Smart because I could have never lived up to it anyway.
It was tough.
But you were really smart and are with sound effects and music, and you and Chris Wedes, JP, hit it off from day one, I'm told.
We did. I tippy-toed into his show gently and gingerly because I was scared to death
of
what we're doing. But as time progressed, we were both from Minnesota, and I think there was a Minnesota connection that helped us click. I could read his mind, and he could read mine, and we toyed with each other, and it was great fun. What a
dueling
marvelous
Prescott.
Man.
Yeah. Well, I thought what would be fun right now is to run through, for lack of a better term, your greatest hits.
Well, let's do that.
We have a machine here called the Instant Replay. And I guess we should start at the very beginning of the show, hey?
All right, sounds good to me, and I wish I'd had one of these machines when we did his show.
You can have this one when we're done.
But you've already heard this, I'm sure, but these are four elements in here. Three of them are done by Spike Jones, and one of them is just the cuckoo clock off a sound effects record. But many people called and always asked, what are those songs? And one of them is Dance of the Hours, and the other is William Tell Overture, but done by Spike Jones in the 40s. And this was JP's theme
for a long
time.
So you just borrowed this song.
Well, yeah, actually, it was created before I started the show. But the camera at the beginning
now, what's happening right here?
We've just now gone inside the set. JP is snoozing. Sound asleep on his stove and a chest. And then he always had a character, the Esmeralda, Griswold, or whatever, that would reach up and beep his nose and
make
just
that
exactly
sound.
Like that.
All
and
right.
Matter of fact, we saw a little clip of that earlier, but that's...
Now, Mr. Announcer Man also had your own intro.
We did. He put on his radar ears, we played the gong as he bowed, and eventually I introduced In the Mood, and the first day we used it, Chris didn't know I was going to do it, or JP didn't know I was going to do it. He and Esmeralda danced around and around the set. It was an instant hit, and we used it every day for the rest of his show.
Now, you were telling me earlier a good trivia question. We'll see how many people might know this. There was one entity on the show that JP Patches never quite saw.
Right. We all saw this character, and it was at the end. That's him. Do you know who it is? Exactly right. That's the Tippocatty Bird. Chris never saw it. It was on a rope that a floor director would drop down.
And as soon as he would turn to look, it'd be gone.
It'd be gone.
Yeah.
And it was great fun, but JP never, ever saw the Tippocatty Bird.
Now, you built an intro for the alluring Gertrude as well. Let's listen
to
that.
There she is.
Had her friends Fred and Ethel, who frequently followed along.
They were pigs,
yeah. And we never ever saw them. But
another of Bob's characters, the Animal Man, Ketchikan, the Animal Man.
Oh yes, Ketchikan, fabulous Bob Newman. He'd come in, they'd march around the set, and at a point in time, JP would reach up on the top of Ketchikan's pith helmet. Be careful how you say that.
What?
The pith helmet.
Pith helmet.
And he'd tap him on the head, and the music would stop.
Well, you know, one man that seemed pithed all the time was Boris S. Wart.
Exactly. And his pet Carmen Dragon, who we also never saw, but we'd hear Carmen do his blah, 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 blah. But
now we heard someone in the audience do the ICU TV quite well, but
yes.
It was actually came from you, and this was it.
And of course, I cleverly borrowed that from an Our Man Flint movie, but I thought it worked well when.